Okay. Well, first of all, if I captured the place people are sitting correctly last time, here's the place where it looks like that I have everybody recorded at. Please look at this, find your name, and see if you're sitting in the seat that corresponds to the position on here. If not, let me know after class. Okay. So today we're going to have some fun. We're not going to be real detailed. We're going to talk a little bit about statistics, have some fun with statistics. We'll talk a little bit about some key historical developments. I think sometimes it's interesting to look backwards to go forwards. So we're going to look backwards at things that have happened in the field. Then we'll give some additional device models, and we'll talk a little bit about logic circuits with the first device models. As I mentioned, we're going to work with device models basically from today, probably through the last lecture in the course. And those device models will be improved over time, and we'll try to use the right model at the right time. The goal, of course, will be to get by with as simple a model as we can for a particular application. Review from last time, we talked about fault modeling. We saw that the hard yield was equal to e to the minus ad, where a is the die area and d is the defect density. This gives you some good indication as to what's going to cost to manufacture an IC in volume production. A lot of times you'll have an idea in mind. You'll go to an equation like this after you think you know what the market will bear, and it'll give you some idea whether it's a project you can work on or not. We also talked about soft yield. Soft yield is associated with parametric variations, things like offset voltage and op amps and so forth. And there can be a loss of components there that don't meet the specifications. The overall yield is typically the product of the two. They're usually uncorrelated. The cost per good die was the cost per fab die divided by the overall yield. And we knew how to calculate the cost for a fab die, and this gives us the cost for a good die. We talked a little bit about statistics. We said whether or not you look at statistics, statistics oftentimes govern what goes on, not just in IC design, but in almost any design you'll do. There's underlying statistical implications as to what that system is going to do. You have a choice of either understanding what goes on, or when you get done, have a surprise. And the surprise may be something you like, or it may be something you don't like. But statistics will typically govern what really is going to happen in most designs. We talked about the Six Sigma challenge, and as I mentioned, a lot of companies say Six Sigma or else. And it was introduced by Bill Smith of Motorola in 1984. Two-thirds of the Fortune 500 companies either have adopted or are adopting Six Sigma concepts. In regard to the or else, question is, what happens if people in the company don't buy into the Six Sigma challenge? And as I mentioned, I asked a VP of one of the companies that's doing something very similar to this, what if an employee chooses not to buy into this? And this was not meant to be a political, not meant to be a political statement. I prepared this slide before the last presidential election. But what we mean by the or else, if you don't buy into it, well, there's the words. Now it's interesting. So I've got to be careful on how we project this. This is the express view of people I've seen in industry. But I've walked into offices of some engineers and maybe asked questions about how they are adopting or committed to or understand the Six Sigma approach. And sometimes they close the door and say, well, it's kind of business as usual. So on the surface, everybody is buying in. Reality is they buy into part of the concepts, but not other parts of the concepts. That's what I want to talk about today. Because it is an important concept. We have problems with yield in systems, and we need to have ways to address the yield. This is one way to do that. So, if you look at yield at the Six Sigma level, assumption was made by Bill Smith that your Yield was characterized by a Gaussian distribution. This is true in many, many, many manufacturing processes. And when he said he expects to have Six Sigma performance, he expected the probability that a part was good, any place in the system, was going to always be at the Six Sigma level. That means it's equal to area under the normal 0-1 distribution PDF from -6 to +6. And he wants everything in the process flow to be that way. So if you're designing a circuit, that circuit is supposed to meet Six Sigma performance. If another person on your team is designing a circuit, that circuit is supposed to meet Six Sigma performance. And the idea is you put a whole bunch of things together, you'll get very good yield. So every step in the process is supposed to be at the Six Sigma level. Now let's see how good this has to be if you're going to be at the Six Sigma level. So if you look at the area under this curve, it's equal to twice the cumulative distribution function of the normal 0-1 distribution at 6 minus 1. For those who've been through the stat course, you should have seen this. You may have seen this in a high school course also when you talk about the normal distribution. Anyway, you can look up this. This appears on your calculator. It appears in tables. And you'll find that 2fn of 6 minus 1 is equal to 0.999999998. That means that the yield is pretty high. In fact, it corresponds to about two defects out of 1 billion parts. If the automotive industry met Six Sigma performance on automobiles going to the customer, would we need repair shops?
Eventually, because we live in Iowa.
So something may eventually wear out. But at least when we ship to the customer, that would be two defective vehicles out of a billion. Would we have very many defective vehicles coming out? How long does it take the U.S. industry to make a billion vehicles? Many years, right? So basically, we would be putting out almost all vehicles that had no defects. So this is a really high yield. You can look at the yield at different value for sigma. So if you look at Six Sigma performance, we said it was about two parts in a billion. If you look at Five Sigma performance, that means you're within plus or minus Five Sigma, the yield drops a lot. It's 5.7 E minus 7. If you have Four Sigma performance, it's 6.3 E minus 5. Well, these are still very good yields up here. In fact, even a Two Sigma performance, you have about a 96% yield, okay? But Bill Smith wants Six Sigma performance, two defects in a billion. Now, he made another assumption that really surprises me. He assumed that the performance or yield will drop for some reason by 1.5 sigma after a process has been established. So people work real hard to get Six Sigma performance, and then you can get lax over time and let things fall off to the 4.5 sigma level. That was his assumption. The reason it surprised me that he made that assumption is in the semiconductor industry, you put out a product today, and the expectation is that the yield goes up with time, not down. So he came to the semiconductor industry, and in 84, he assumed things were going to degrade a little bit over time. That's no longer acceptable. When you put something out today, you'll expect that your yield will improve as that product matures in production. Does that make sense? Okay. So then the assumption is we're going to have 4.5 sigma performance after we mature our process, and that's no longer so challenging. Instead of two defects in a billion, this will allow 3.4 defects in a billion. Is that a high defect rate? No, that's still a very low defect rate, isn't it? So if you look at a million automobiles coming out of the line in Detroit, out of that, on the average, about 3.5 of them would have a defect. really meet that kind of performance? No, almost nothing that we get to the consumer will really get to this 4.5 sigma level. So we point out that, I want to point out then, that the Six Sigma concept that was introduced by Bill Smith at Motorola is a highly statistical concept. And this shows what happens over time then. You start out at the Six Sigma level on the right, and over time you allow the process to degrade. So let's look at an example to see if Bill Smith was realistic in his expectations of engineers at Motorola. And this may be one reason when I walked into the office of some of the students that I knew that had been, or some of the engineers I knew that had been former students, why they raised some questions about the actual commitment to the Six Sigma approach. So let's determine the maximum die area in a circuit if it's initially to meet Six Sigma challenge for hard yield defects. So we know that there's a relationship between the yield and the defect and the die area, right? So determine the maximum die area if the circuit yield is to initially meet the Six Sigma challenge for hard defects. And then I'm going to ask a question. Is it realistic to set a Six Sigma die yield expectation on the design and process engineers? So as the die area gets bigger, your yield is going to drop. We want to have performance initially at the Six Sigma level. So how big can you have a die and still meet that Six Sigma performance? That question makes sense? Okay. So the Six Sigma challenge requires meeting a Six Sigma standard deviation. So what we can do then is set the yield at 2 times Fn minus x minus 1, that 2 parts in a billion. And this is the yield as it relates to the area and the defect density. So the area, if I take the natural log of that, is equal to minus the natural log of the yield divided by the defect density. And I'm going to assume the defect density is 1 per square centimeter. That's a very good defect density. And that tells us that the area that we can have for our die, if we're going to need 6 sigma performance, is 250,000 square angstroms. A 250 square angstrom die. Is that a big die or a small die? It's angstroms now. It's not microns. It's not centimeters. It's angstroms. Let's put it in perspective. 2,500 square angstroms would be an area that would be 500 angstroms by 500 angstroms. If you look at this area, if you have a 20 nanometer process, the dimensions of the transistor would be 200 angstroms by 200 angstroms, just the gate area of the transistor. So this area of 500 angstroms by 500 angstroms is about enough area to make one transistor in a 20 nanometer process. At the time Bill Smith proposed this, it would have been about enough area. He was probably in a 7 micron process at the time. It would have been enough area to make about a tenth of a transistor. I wonder why the engineers were not committed to designs that were going to meet the Six Sigma performance. Never see the issue. So what do you do when the boss comes in and says, we're going to meet Six Sigma performance on your designs, and you calculate the area, there's not enough area to make one transistor? When the boss in the room, are you committed to the Six Sigma challenge? Yes. You want to put products out the door? Yes. Are you going to put products out the door at the Six Sigma level? No. Make sense? So this number was picked out of the air someplace. And it's a very attractive number, but it's an unrealistic challenge to place on designers. So the best technology in the world have orders of magnitude 2-day defects to build any useful integrated circuits with die yields that meet the Six Sigma performance. Arbitrarily, so keep in mind when Bill Smith set this number, he didn't say where it came from. He was trying to improve profitability by having products that had higher yield, but arbitrarily setting a yield level will typically guarantee financial fiascos. Okay. So meeting a real Six Sigma challenge, Six Sigma or else? In fact, improving the yield by even one sigma, we're at Six Sigma, we're not even close. Going from 6 to 5 is a major effort. Going from 5 to 4 is a major effort. Improving the yield by even one sigma is oftentimes very challenging. So we're not even close to something that we can expect to do. So statistics are useful. Statistics are your friends. If you read the paper about statistics predicting lots of different things, whether it's political events or economic events, whatever the case might be, you have statistics given all the time, but there's seldom information given about exactly what questions were asked when the statistics are given. In many cases, those statistics are used to manipulate and they're being abused. Make sense? Six Sigma approaches, statistics are being abused. Now, if statistics are abused, it doesn't necessarily mean that they're abused intentionally. A lot of people try to make statements about statistics when they don't understand statistics. So many that are not knowledgeable incorrectly use statistics. I can't imagine that Bill Smith wasn't knowledgeable. Many use statistics to intentionally mislead the public. Some openly abuse statistics for financial gain or for manipulation purposes. So keep an open mind when you see statistics used to separate good statistics. Statistics are your friend, but keep an open mind so you separate good statistics from abused statistics. Can anybody think of examples in the press where they see statistical statements made and say, wow, where did they get that? Can we really conclude that? I'm sure, has everybody seen stuff like that? Let's talk about how Motorola fared with the Six Sigma approach. Motorola was an American multinational telecommunications company based in Schaumburg, Illinois. Oops. Was. This comes from Wikipedia. Which was evenly divided into two independent public companies, Motorola Mobility and Motorola Solutions, in 2011. After losing $4.3 billion from 2007 to 2009. This doesn't tell how much money they lost between the time Bill Smith proposed this idea and 2007 either. Remember, he did that in 1984. So let's see how Motorola fared. If you look at the ticker tape, MOT for Motorola, this is not necessarily a good indicator of how the company's doing. So Motorola is defunct, and there's a couple of small groups that still maintain the Motorola moniker. So Motorola sold its military activities to General Dynamics in 2000-2001. They sold the automotive products in 2006. They spun off the discrete components as ON Semiconductor in 1999. They spun off the semiconductor product sector as Freescale in 2003. Freescale has been morphed into NXP, and now it's becoming part of Qualcomm, I believe. They sold Motorola Mobility to Google in 2011, and there's 23,000 people were left. This was about 2 years ago I prepared this slide. They were down from over 150,000 people in the mid-90s, at the time Bill Smith made this this prediction, or this approach. So here's kind of showing how the size of their company has dwindled, how they became defunct, and a little bit of salvaging of the Motorola name. So I don't want to claim that the Six Sigma approach was responsible for the demise of Motorola. But certainly the Six Sigma approach did not save Motorola. So, Six Sigma else. The Six Sigma capability has almost nothing to do with optimizing profits. And in a company, you want to optimize profits. And if taken seriously, will likely guarantee a financial fiasco. We saw what happens if you're trying to get an IC and trying to meet Six Sigma performance. Let's see, what do we do then? Well, first of all, I don't want people to leave with the idea that Six Sigma approaches are bad. If two-thirds of the Fortune 500 property companies adopt Six Sigma approaches, and you go in and say, my professor at Iowa State said this is something that you've got to watch out for, probably wouldn't look good for me and maybe not look good for you. Okay. The concept of improving reliability, or really profitability, is good. And I think that a lot of things they do with the Six Sigma approaches, where they forget about the statistics, and they try to put the focus on improving communication, improving processes and so forth to increase yields. That's all really good. It's just the statistics that are abused in trying to do this. Okay. So, meeting Six Sigma challenge. Hopefully everybody got the message. Important concept. Related to yield, I was at a company a few years ago, and I was making a comment that you don't necessarily want to have a good yield in this particular design. And my host just about took me to the door when I made that statement. He says, how dare you tell our employees that we don't want a good yield? So here's the perception. The perception is that as the yield improves, or as the standard deviation goes up, the earnings per die go up. That's the perception. And if that's the case, our goal would be to have a real high yield and everything, right? That's the perception. Reality is more like this. If you start improving your yield, you typically see an improvement in profit. And as you improve the yield even more, it flattens out. And if you try to start improving the yield even more, it turns around and goes back down. So if you wanted to set up a yield target, what should your yield target be? What?
Peak profit.
So what we need to do is we need to set a yield target where that profit peaks. We don't want to arbitrarily pick a number where that what that yield is going to be. Does that make sense? You can certainly see what happens if you fix it, say, your performance. Instead of being profitable, you'll almost always be in the loss column.
Is that because you're spending resources on improving the yield and that cuts down your profit?
No, that's not the reason. It's really hard to get really, 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 really high yields. There's defects that are present in the system for hard yield issues. And nobody knows how to get rid of the defects, and they never will get rid of the defects. You're stuck with the defects. So it's just that it's really expensive to improve that yield. It's not expensive to get it up to a reasonable level. Maybe it's not hard to get it up to 90% or 95% or 99% for some products. But 99.99 or 99.9999, that gets to be really expensive to do that. Make sense? perception on earnings per die. Again, profit goes up as the yield approaches 100%. Reality is something like this. Cost per good die is probably what we're interested in. The cost per good die, we take the cost per die divided by the yield, so we know what the die area might be. If you have a low yield, the cost per good die is going to be bigger than the cost for the fabricated die. As the yield goes up, the cost per good die will go down, usually. But then at some yield level, it'll turn around and head back up again.
And it approaches infinity
as the yield approaches 100%. Okay. Now, what I was trying to convey when I said you don't want to have a really, really high yield, I was trying to convey that this happens if you try to push the yield too high. And the person I was visiting with was of the mindset that this is what the yield looks like. Okay. So as was pointed out, the goal of the designer should be to optimize profits, not to optimize yield, but to optimize profits. Let's talk a little bit about, yes?
I have a question. Where did the defects come from in this system? Is it from the silicon itself when you grow it, or is it from the printing of the circuits? Or is it both?
It's both, but it's dominantly from the printing of the circuits. Okay. So what happens is you take the silicon wafer, there will be a few defects in the silicon, so those contribute to the yield. You put photoresist on, and then you shine light through some optics, and there's occasionally a dust particle, and that dust particle can be of different sizes, and they screw up the lithography process. When you develop it, there's not perfect homogeneity in the photoresist. When you do etching, we'll talk about these steps, there's occasionally some irregularities that occur locally in that, and that's what causes the defects. The industry has been working to reduce the defect rate ever since the first ICs were manufactured. We've got very good processes, but we will never eliminate the defects. That make sense? Some historical developments. In 1925 and 1935, the concept of the MOS transistor was proposed by Lillian Field in 25 and by Heil in 35, one in the US and one in Europe. Proposed, but not. And actually, one of them was patented. In 1947, the BJT was conceived and experimentally verified. So not only did they conceive the bipolar transistor, they verified it. Bardeen, Bratton, and Shockley of Bell Labs did that. It's kind of interesting because Shockley was a brilliant physicist. And Bardeen and Bratton actually demonstrated it first. Shockley had a reputation for being a bit abrasive. And he tried to scoop his two colleagues on it and try to claim credit for the bipolar transistor. We'll talk a little more about Shockley a little bit later. In 1959, Jack Kilby of TI and Bob Noyce of Fairchild at the time invented the IC. They both in 1959, about 6 months apart. Kilby was first. But Kilby didn't have the interconnects figured out. Noyce was a few months later, and he had the interconnects figured out as well. These guys are both Midwesterners. We talked about Noyce before. What else did Noyce do besides invent the IC? Co-founder of Fairchild.
Intel.
Co-founder of Intel. Where did you grow up at? In Iowa, at Grinnell. Jack Kilby came from Kansas. And both of these people were in the early 30s at the time this happened. In 1963, Juan Lissa Fairchild experimentally verified the first MOS gate. So you went from 1925 to 1963.
Until we were finally able to build a MOS transistor.
Okay.
So what came first? The MOS transistor or the bipolar transistor? Experimentally, the bipolar. Conceptually, the MOS device. Let's talk a little bit about the MOS transistor. It was initially an idea, but little more. So here is Lilienfeld. And here is Heil, the two people that invented the MOS transistor. And the patents that they had for that are given there. If you look at a cross-section of the MOS transistor that they proposed, it's very similar to what we look at today. They just didn't know how to build it. Talk a little bit about the vacuum tube era. Has anybody ever seen a vacuum tube? They still occur occasionally in some power amplifiers for the audio industry. And maybe a few other very niche applications. The vacuum tube had a real long run. It was invented in 1910. And although some are still used, the era of the vacuum tube was basically from the invention until ICs really started to have a role. So they invented the integrated circuit in 59. It took the better part of a decade until they really became major players in the industry. So they had a 60-year lifespan. 60-year lifespan is 2.5 generations of engineers. Is that a long lifespan? Yeah. It was considered to be a major breakthrough in electronic technology. A 6-plus decade lifespan. Unfortunately, vacuum tubes were expensive. So they were really not affordable by all of society. And they were heavy, they were hot, they were expensive, they were big, they were horribly unreliable, and they're very fragile. Lots of bad properties that a vacuum tube had. It was the only amplifiers we had at the time. That's why they had such a long run. And there were millions and millions and millions of radios like this. Probably had 5 tubes in the inside. And you can see the tubes in that radio set. If you look at the circuit here, we could go ahead and actually analyze a circuit if we wanted to later on in this course, or at least most of what's going on in there. There's almost a one-to-one replacement for tubes and MOS transistors. It also employed lots of people. If you drove around the country, you would see repair shops all over the place. People that knew how to repair televisions later on and radios that were built with tubes. The reason they had to do that is the tubes were so unreliable. Not only that, the resistors and capacitors in particular, were also quite unreliable at that time. So bipolar junction transistor was in 47 was considered to be a replacement for the vacuum tube. That would overcome some of the really big problems with the vacuum tube. So this group of Bell Labs, Bardeen, Bratton, and Shockley, who invented it, says, we have called it a transistor because it is a resistor or a semiconductor device which can amplify electrical signals as they are transferred from it from input to the output terminals. Okay, so that was their claim. It is, if you will, the electrical equivalent of a vacuum tube amplifier. Real clean. But it has no vacuum, no filament, no glass tubes. It is composed entirely of cold, solid substances. So you got this little transistor, and they're making a claim this can replace these big vacuum tubes that have all these problems. You can see why there was a lot of buzz associated with the bipolar transistor when it was invented. Here's Mr. Shockley, a brilliant physicist. He found the transistor and brought silicon to Silicon Valley. The reason that Silicon Valley is where it's at is he decided to go to Silicon Valley and or the Orange Grove area in south of San Francisco
and rented a small garage and started trying to make transistors in there. Now, it was a garage, I guess. So these are some comments by Gordon Moore. Now, when Shockley went out there, some of the people he hired initially, he had a group of a half a dozen key people in what was called Shockley Semiconductor. One of the people he hired was Noyce. One of the people he hired was Moore. And the other people he hired went on to form major semiconductor companies as well, most of them did. The story about Noyce. Noyce went on from Iowa to MIT, and so the story has, and I think it's true, he decided he wanted to make transistors. So he packed up where he was living at and went out to Shockley and asked for a job. He had two small kids at the time. He was confident enough he could get a job that he quit his job that he had, packed up, drove across the country, knocked on the door and said, I want a job making transistors. He fathered, these are Moore's comments, he fathered the transistor and brought the silicon to Silicon Valley, but is remembered by many only for his noxious racial views. Let me know what that means. Shockley, of course, is dead now, but he would be pleased to have me or any of you say that he was a brilliant physicist, because he really was. And he would be pleased to hear you say he was a really smart guy, because he really was. He also made statements like he was smarter than his family. He also made statements like white people were smarter than people from other races and so forth. And he was on the faculty at Stanford when he was making those statements. And he used his reputation as a brilliant physicist to convey racial views, which he had no scientific evidence to support his views. So that's where the noxious racial views comment comes from. A couple more comments about Shockley. He formed this company. He had these people like Gordon Moore and Bob Noyce working for him. Within a few months, they bolted and formed Fairchild. He had a difficult time getting people to work with him because of his lack of tact in personal interactions. And after he was out there for 3 or 4 years, he left the semiconductor industry, went to Stanford, and that's when he became a sociologist or whatever you want to call it, what he was working on. Integrated circuit. Here we see a top view similar where you're going to look in the laboratory. Here we see some packages that contain an integrated circuit on the inside. Here was Kilby's patent. It was issued in 1960, where it's interesting, because it was filed in 1959, and it took till 1964, it took 5 years for that patent to issue, the patent for the integrated circuit. And you can see the wires he's showing on this integrated circuit, because he didn't have the interconnects figured out. Here's a picture of Jack. I'm only standing here today because of Jack Kilby. When I was at Texas A&M as a young faculty member, the department chairman came to the faculty one day and said, is anybody interested in trying to put together an IC design program? Not knowing much about what he was talking about, I ended up raising my hand. Apparently this guy by the name of Jack Kilby was going to come to A&M to work with setting up an IC design program. And so he was the catalyst that tried to get the program going we had there at the time. It was really a privilege to have a chance to interact with Jack on a few occasions as that program was being established. Here's a picture of his IC. The patent looked much nicer than his experimental results. I used to hear the statement made that Jack didn't know, he knew a little bit about everything, but not a lot about anything. But I was in several discussions when Jack was in the room, and it didn't make any difference whether people talked about circuits or devices or opera. Jack was usually the most knowledgeable person in the room. He was a very well-read, very knowledgeable individual that understood how the world around him operates. Very, very perceptive, very good at identifying opportunities as well.
He had something else. What was one of his other patents? Integrated circuit was, of course, a non-trivial one. The handheld calculator, I believe, was also a patent that Jack Kilby had. Here's Bob Noyes, and we just looked at his patent. Jack Kilby was 34 years old at the time it was invented. Bob Noyes was 31 at the time he did his initial IC. 1971, Intel introduces the first microprocessor. It had 2,300 transistors. Now, what does the processor have? Several billion. And this is the processor that was introduced by Intel. I was going to talk about logic circuits. I guess we'll start on logic circuits on Friday. That's all for today. Thanks.
I have a question for you about the homework.
Yes.
On one of them, it says.